So hello, and welcome to the Columbia Justice Lab screening of College Behind Bars and the following panel discussion with Barred Prison Initiative. We are so excited to have all of you here, and welcome again. My name is Julie Monaharan. I'm with the Columbia Justice Lab. This is my wonderful colleague, and she will be our moderator, Madison Dawkins. We'll introduce Madison in just a minute, but I just want to run through a couple of IT items before we get started. So first of all, we have over 200 people registered for this event and already almost 60 people on the line at 6:01. And I just want to say that it's incredibly exciting and powerful to see people coming together virtually in a time when it's really easy to feel far apart. So thank you for that. So for audience members, you are muted and your video is disabled. So that is automatic and that is going to remain the case for the duration of the event. If you do want to ask any questions for the panelists, we have a Q&A portion at the end of the event, and you can ask questions by hitting the Q&A button on the bottom of your Zoom window. So if you sort of scroll to the bottom of your window, you'll see Q&A. If you click on that, you can ask your question and we'll be pulling questions from that function. The film itself has been looking really wonderful, but just in case there's any kind of streaming issue, just so you know, we do have a backup plan. We'll just be sending a link over the chat function, which again, you can see in that bottom bar. We'll let you know if that happens. I don't think that's going to be an issue, but just so you know. After the video, we will have the panel discussion. Super excited about that. And during the panel discussion, we recommend using the gallery view. So that allows you to just see all of the speakers all at once, as opposed to just the person who is speaking. You can get your gallery view by going to the top right-hand corner of your Zoom window. It will either say speaker view or gallery view. If it says gallery view, you just want to click it and make sure that you can see all of your speakers. If you have any IT issues, you can use that chat function that I mentioned, and someone from our team will try to help you out as soon as we can. I think that that is it for tech, and I will turn it over to Madison. Thanks so much, and looking forward to this event.
Thank you so much, Julie. Good evening. Thank you for joining us. My name is Madison Dawkins, and I'm a project coordinator at the Square One Project out of the Columbia University Justice Lab. Square One considers the fundamentals of justice and asks the question, if we could start from square one, how would justice policy be different? This evening, we will be viewing a 30-minute segment of the College Behind Bars documentary series, which focuses on the lives and academic pursuits of incarcerated students who are enrolled in the Barred Prison Initiative. This documentary series is currently streaming on Netflix and is accessible for free on PBS. Following the screening, there will be a panel discussion with two Barred Prison Initiative alumnus, Daiwan Tetro and Giovanni Hernandez, along with the executive director of the Barred Prison Initiative, Max Kenner. I have seen the extraordinary value of college offerings in correctional facilities firsthand while serving as a teaching assistant and volunteer for a health, wellness, and mindfulness course at the Riverside Correctional Facility in Philadelphia. So I am so excited that everyone is joining us this evening to learn more about the Barred Prison Initiative. Thank you again for joining us this evening. We will now turn to the viewing portion of our programming. Thank you.
I've been incarcerated for 13 years. And from my experience, I can tell you, prison is here to punish us. It's here to warehouse us. But it's not about rehabilitating. It's not about creating productive beings. It just isn't.
Thank you.
told me, Ishmael, some years ago, never mind how long precisely, I have a little or no money in my purse and nothing particular to interest me on the shore. I thought I would sell about a little and see the watery part of the world.
I'm taking Moby Dick. Oh, that's a really interesting class. The whole first paragraph we had to memorize. And each one of us had to recite in front of the rest of the class. You would see another guy in the class in the yard, and we would be like, hey, call me Ishmael. And he would go through it, and I would go through it, and we'd point out where we didn't match.
I thought I would sail about a little and see the watery part of the world. Is the way I have of regulating this spleen and try and
Is the way I have of driving off the spleen and regulating the circulation.
Whenever I find myself growing grim about the mouth, whenever it is a damn drizzly November in my soul, whenever I find myself involuntarily pausing before coffin warehouses and bringing up the rear of every funeral I meet, and especially whenever my high pulse gets such an upper hand of me that it requires a strong moral principle to prevent me from deliberately stepping out into the streets and methodically knocking people hats off their heads, then I account it high time to get to sea as soon as I can.
How would you feel about that?
Remember that the crisis that the United States was in the early 1930s was a global economic crisis. And that crisis led to the rise of all kinds of anti-democratic regimes all over the world. And what Roosevelt's concerned about is the possibility that this could happen in the United States.
We are not a part of the prison system. We are a college who happens to have classes inside a prison. Unlike other schools, it has bars, it has gates that close and open, it has doors that must be locked. Although we say school building, it's not a traditional school building. Although what we do inside the school building is traditional college work.
One of the things that's always been most important to us is the institution's adamance that these students, the incarcerated students, are no different from any other. And in many ways, BPI is simply a very simple kind of experiment, which is what happens when we provide the kinds of education that typically in the United States are only afforded to the children of the lucky, or the entitled, or the rich, to others.
Get rid of any draft. So you can see there's a lot of rewrites. I spend most of my time in the school building. If I'm in the cell, more often than not, I'm either reading, writing, or sleeping. This is a cell. This is not a place that I live in. Well, as you can see, there's no pictures or posters on the wall at all. I keep this bare. I don't forget that this is prison, even when I'm working. Because at some point, being an officer, he's gonna walk past this cell. I'm gonna hear the keys jangling on his belt, and he might stop by that cell and look through that window there. And so I don't forget. You never forget.
I do most of my work at night because it's a dorm, it's an open space. There are a lot of distractions, you know, guys walking around, talking loudly. It's not always easy to focus on schoolwork, so I may start a lot of my work maybe at 11 at night and go to bed 2-3 in the morning. I try to be as organized as I can be in such a small space. So, you know, I utilize like little folders and things. Miscellaneous papers. Papers for every semester, for every class, for the last 5 years. I came in when I was 16. I got my GED on Rikers Island in 2005. A friend of mine forced me into the program, which probably the kindest, most loving thing anyone has ever done for me. It forced me to apply to this program.
Just all textbooks, math, science, and then, of course, Spanish is invading my life. So that's my, for the next 2.5 years, it will be Spanish, biology, math. I keep myself very Spartan and school-oriented as a buffer against prison life. Prison can get inside of you. It's invasive, and I try to keep it out. And school is by one of the means that I keep it out.
I majored in German studies. The language was so hard. However, now, I love to read about American news in German. One of the things that really attracted me about Germany was its historical mistake and then the manner in which it tried to really make up for that mistake. This is my cell. This is where I rest my head, get my thoughts together, do my schoolwork. You have my sink, my window. You see, I don't have much of a view of much out there, but it's all right. Definitely look forward to having a different environment when I get out. But now I gotta make the most of what I have, you know?
The overwhelming majority of our students will be sent back to the communities typically from which they came, and will engage with their families and those communities, and they will be better at that when they're educated in a way that's meaningful to them.
This is my third full semester. Bar just gets progressively harder. I had a professor tell us, you know, I teach college. and I teach to the best students in the most elite universities in the country, and that's what I'm gonna do here. Let's get started. When someone tells you that, it's a whole new day.
I was just thinking, you have this Irish population who's kind of against the role of government in their lives, and yet they seem to be the ones advocating for like a greater government presence in some sense. Like, how's that? Can you speak about that tension?
It's about power. Okay. And using power to actually both protect themselves, but also to secure their position within the greater urban, you know, complex. Several of you have in the past referenced things like W.B. Du Bois' double consciousness, right? But there's no reason not to extend that metaphor to the Irish.
Okay, so they constantly have to negotiate or renegotiate this tension?
The tension is obvious for us. But in fact, like Du Bois' double consciousness, it's not that, you know, one day you're one thing and the next day you're the next. It's in fact actually that there are two emotional, personal, communal struggles happening within you. There are things that, you know, I take for granted when I'm teaching at MIT that I can just do that I can't do here. The mixed media that you'll use inside a classroom at an elite institution that I can't reproduce here. Here, you go back to a more basic teaching structure.
So what else I have, you know? So U1, A1, U2, A2, so U3, A3, and plus now, U4, A4, okay?
Our students in BPI show up to class extraordinarily well prepared. And so a lot of that sort of gimmickry that we need, we don't need here as much because actually everyone's done the reading.
Essentially what you're doing is you're combining all of the components
I'm going to just put this, you see, I just use commutativity, you know, and
so
put
you're
this
collecting
one
the terms.
And this one together, you know, so that's what I'm looking for, okay? That's what I'm looking for.
下面这个part是什么？马。所以所有的vehicle，所有的vehicle，这是什么？这是听，这是什么？我不记得。这是什么？Your
car already stopped. Zaishuo
There you go.
Being in prison for so long, I can't say the things that I experienced there are no longer part of me.
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since.
I was on a train and this lady got on. She explained she was homeless and she would sing a song for us. And she sung Sam Cooke's, I believe, A Change Gonna Come. And that was one song when I was in prison that I always felt emotional whenever I heard it. So she went through this beautiful rendition of Sam Cooke's A Change Gonna Come on Prison Act. The tears was flooding in my eyes. And when she finished, the first thought that came to my head was, I gotta get out of prison. Here I am standing on the A train, and the thought came in my head, I need to get out of prison. I have to remind myself, yo, you don't have to worry about that no more.
The majority of prisoners in New York State come from New York City. And they come from the worst neighborhoods in New York City, that also have the worst schools in New York City, that have the lowest quality of education in New York City. And then they wind up in prison. college was not something that was on their radar.
Gene therapy. Let's kind of sketch out the terrain of what we're talking about here.
People trying to get into Bard, they never know what it is like until they get in. We try to convince someone that this is worth doing. They say, well, you know, I don't want to be up all night. They're like, look at you guys. But it's worth it. And they say, why? And you can't answer that question because it's not something you know until you get in the classroom with really, really great professors and they start teaching you how smart you are.
Carla, so we're still talking about why this is such a matter of heated ethical debate.
Well, one of the main concerns with stem cells is that there's this right that future generations have that we will be basically impeding.
Terrific, very well put.
BPI was the most challenging thing I've ever undertaken academically. Before then, everything I did academically was easy. That wasn't. But as I struggled and I worked hard and I started taking my education to another level, I started kind of feeling cheated. Cheated by my early education, by my high school education, the fact that it wasn't challenging enough. There is a dual educational system in this country, one for individuals who will rule and one for everyone else. And there's something inherently wrong and short-sighted in this because it takes for granted all the potential that lies at that other level, that they never get an opportunity to meet their potential. And what's the ramification of that for American society?
In the beginning, my mom said, you know, you did your crime, you're gonna do your time. And she said she wasn't going to do anything for me.
Oh, hi, son.
But I have a child out there. My mom felt as if because she's able to overcome things, everyone else was able to overcome them. Everything I did for Tamika is because I loved her first. And because my daughter, Nicole, who was a correction officer, said, Ma, you have to go see her because it will make her time better. But if you want to spend better time, then you wouldn't have went to jail. I'm not allowed to go to the computer lab to type up my papers until the evening times when we don't have program hours.
Although this is my tax dollars, and if you commit a crime, I wouldn't give a rat's ass to the time. It shouldn't be fun. It's not supposed to be fun,
but a prison system is supposed to rehabilitate people, and it's supposed to
Panama,
help you
go to Panama.
It doesn't matter.
Go to Panama.
I'm not in Panama.
Go
I'm
to
in
different
the United
countries
States of
where.
So would you prefer us to
I
sit
prefer
here?
For people not to commit crimes and waste right. my tax dollars for this bullshit.
Okay, so Ma, you
That's
happen
what
to,
I prefer.
You happen
okay,
to have, I'm gonna you happen to have made yourself into a good life.
Who me?
You happen to you happen
How
to
you
have,
know I live a good life.
You happen to have made yourself into a good life.
I was never a criminal, okay? I never committed crimes, and I was never a criminal. So I don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
And you
right
was 12.
Now.
Right, so now, when you're in prison, you're supposed to be able to get reformed or rehabilitated. You would want to get the same education that we're in here getting.
My frustration was new because I never really let it out. I don't know that this program is privately funded. Okay, all I know is that my daughter got a free diploma when I have to pay for my other kids to go to school. So for that, I might as well just go ahead and commit a crime that might be forgiven with society, and let me just do 2 years and go get me a degree. We just ain't gonna see eye to eye ever.
A lot of people think the way my mother thinks. I made a mistake. And I learned from that mistake, and then I took advantage of the opportunities I could have. Just because I'm in prison doesn't mean that I shouldn't be able to go to school. Doesn't mean that I shouldn't be able to pick up a skill so I can work in a job somewhere doing something legal.
We have to remember that there are a lot of people who believe that what we do is wrong in a moral way. But there's no question over the course of years that we have been doing this work that the politics have changed in an extraordinary way. At the local, the state, and the federal level.
Now to a bipartisan effort on Capitol Hill to try to reform the nation's criminal justice system.
And so what we really need is a broad-based transformation of criminal justice that actually saves taxpayer dollars, empowers people to succeed, and keeps our streets safe.
Senator Paul, you come from a very different political worldview than Senator Booker, but you see this the same way he does?
Well, I think the interesting thing is I don't think it's a right or a left issue. I think it's an issue that we both believe strongly in.
Every year, we spend $80 billion to keep folks incarcerated. $80 billion. What I couldn't do with $80 billion. It's a lot of money. For what we spend to keep everyone locked up for 1 year, we could eliminate tuition at every single one of our public colleges and universities. Mass incarceration makes our country worse off. And we need to do something about it.
This summer, the Obama administration said it as a pilot project, the Department of Education will partner with 67 colleges to provide higher education to prisoners who can't afford it.
Matter is that we're only 10% of the population in one prison. In one prison, we're 10% of the pop. What about the other prisons in the system, right? And the lack of programs, the lack of anything meaningful to these. Right? Is anybody like really stopping to explore? When we talk about reform on the ground in here, right, with the guys that we lock around, what does reform look like? What does it even mean to them?
I didn't come to prison to go to college. You know, I came here and I got really, really lucky and did some things right. But at no time do I want to be some type of poster boy for like, look at what prison can do for you. It's a very stressful and kind of disgusting place. You know, it's a bad place. If I had to choose to go to college, I would not do it here.
You framed it as you don't want to be an example of what prison can do for you. It's not what prison is doing for you. This is what education is doing for you.
True.
You go home and say, I messed up. I went to prison. You got lucky, like you said. You made it here. You got into BPI. You learned. And you are no longer the same person you was when we were together in Five Points. Am I wrong?
No, you're not.
Did prison do that for you or did education do that for you?
Education.
When I came to prison, the first thing I was thinking about was how do I get into college? That was my primary concern. And I'm sure I'm not the only one. There are groups all over the prisons, all over them. They're ready. They're ready. They just need the opportunity. And then they will do whatever it takes to get in that seat.
The overwhelming majority of individuals are going to be released from prison. They're coming back home. They're coming back into their communities. So if I'm able to successfully intervene in their lives, then I'm saving further victimization. I'm saving taxpayer dollars.
The way I look at it is, would you prefer a person who messed up sometime in life, committed a crime, got arrested for it, came to prison and did absolutely positively nothing, move next door to you and plot on your house? Or would you prefer a person who messed up, corrected that mistake, got an education, came out and had a good job, and instead of them plotting on your house, you're having barbecues or something together?
this is the final day of the project, so to speak. So we wrote the project, and now we're going in front of three professors and have a discussion.
Welcome, Rodney.
The thesis for the project is that Americans in general have used the black body as an object of rhetoric to define their identities. Black people, for example, used the suffering black body. They used bodies in a way to force America to see the suffering so that you can empathize with their pain. We see this not only with Emmett Till, but we see it with the Black Lives Matter movement, with Mike Brown, with Tamir Rice.
There's a lot of really powerful language, the idea of messianic. That's a really deliberate choice. It's a choice you made a long time ago and you've stayed with, right? This idea of the messianic black body.
Benjamin says that we shouldn't look at history as linear, one event following another and then the other events are in the past. When he says messianic, he's saying that this past is constantly being resurrected. It's constantly re-emerging. Well, when we take the black body, it's a container of all of this history of suffering and resistance. So we have a body of Mike Brown lying in the middle of the street for 4.5 hours. But for many of the African-American activists who are seeing this body in the middle of the street, they're not just seeing Mike Brown. They're seeing all of the previous acts of indignities, injustice. And it's not just their personal experiences, but the entire quote-unquote race. And I think messianic black bodies, it allows me to explain why, again, why African Americans can look at a black body and say, listen, that is all of this history, and it's me.
We need to draw things to a close. So step outside for just a couple minutes.
Yeah. Writing this project, I did feel hopeless. Seeing the body of Emmett Till, it was just very sad. And all of that, it just became so much for me. I had to push the project away at several points during the process and just take a break because it was just heavy. It was just too much for me. So this is the afterword. During the course of my research, I developed a hyper-awareness of the many often insidious ways in which society disfigures the personhood of marginalized people. I noticed the attempt of so many to lump disparate elements into the category of blackness or some other category meant to house the unworthy, categories such as offender or inmate. It is difficult to live, to function in one of these categories. It begins to feel like scurf that one cannot scrub clean from the body. I am a quote, irredeemable, trapped in one of these crippling categories for the undeserving. I'm reluctant to use the word anger. In America, anger and blackness and offender is considered a volatile mixture. But everyone, every single one of us should seethe when injustice is rampant and bodies are falling and the nation is divided about whether or not the losses of Eric Garner, of Laquan McDonald, of Mike Brown, of Trayvon Martin, insert here, are worth mourning. Mourning is not a question of race and bodies. It is a question of humanity. Let me say it plainly. The black body is a prison of flesh, and the truth is unforgiving. African Americans can no more relinquish their signifying black bodies than they can change the history of this nation. But they must continue to demand.
Congratulations, Rodney. Registrar does not allow us to give the grade that we want to give to it, but which would have been an A plus, but since the registrar doesn't allow it, you get an A.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Yes.
Thank
you very much. Thank you. You're welcome. We
spend so much time in America speaking about the violent criminal. I am not worthy of redemption, and part of the reason why we think this is because of the wording, violent criminal. It is not the violent act that you committed 15, 20 years ago, you are a violent criminal. There's something that is inherent about you that we must protect the rest of society away from. This person did something terrible. He should be punished for it. But he's a person. He or she is a person, and they might change. They might not be a bad person. They might not be a bad person.
It's like it's not real. I'm going home. I'm excited, of course, but I'm scared. What's it gonna be like? I mean, of course it's gonna be hard, but like, how hard? I haven't been home since I was 16. I was a kid. I'm gonna be 28. I want my life to be a testament to the person's life I took. That requires working to the best of my ability and making my life itself a symbolic memorial to his. If I don't, it's just like I'm further disrespecting his memory. So I sort of have to make this work. That's the only way I'll be able to redeem myself. In my eyes, in my family's eyes, in society's eyes. That's the only way.
At this point, I'd like to remind our panelists that you can take yourselves off of mute and show your video. I would also like to take a minute to acknowledge that we had Zoom bombers write offensive messages in the chat. And for that, I sincerely apologize. At this point, I'm hoping we can move forward and give our panelists and the Bard Prison Initiative the respect and attention that they deserve. I will now give the panelists an opportunity to introduce themselves and give a few words on the segment we just saw. Daiwan, can you start us off?
Hey, good evening, everyone. My name is Daiwan Tatro. As you've seen, I'm featured in the film. I'm an alumnus of the Bard Prison Initiative, Bard College 2018, and currently the Government Affairs and Advancement Officer at BPI. A few remarks on the film. I think one of the things that always moves me about this film is a lot of the things that we see around incarcerated people in this country tend to be denigrating and demoralizing, and this is the total opposite. This is a story of hope. It inspires us. It makes us feel good watching it.
Giovanni?
Yeah, hi. Hi everyone, Giovanni Hernandez, also an alumnus of the Bard Prison Initiative. Currently the development manager for a small nonprofit called Co-Cooperative. Just something about the film is, especially since we just, you know, we saw the part that always sort of like really catches me, which is like my release, sort of reliving like the happiest moment of your life, like so often. Is, as you can imagine, it's like a really emotional experience for me. But beyond that, I think that for me, the film, what I've gotten from it is more so its reception and then the value of that. And that's been what, sort of what has really just like made all of this feel so much more, so worth it for me, you know, just to be so so candid with one story and one's life and just to have people see the value in that and take, you know, this message that we're trying to deliver on the, you know, the importance of access to education to everyone.
Thank you, Giovanni. And Max?
Thanks, Madison. It's terrific to be here. My name is Max Kenner. I'm the executive director and founder of the Bard Prison Initiative. We offer college opportunity to incarcerated people across New York and are involved in this issue and have been for 20 years all across the country. This film for us, of course, is a extraordinary opportunity for the entire country to see what we witness students do every day. And like Daiwan said, it's an extraordinary counterpoint to what we are used to seeing in the media when we think of portrayals of incarcerated people. I love when I watch this film to think of, you know, what you see on MSNBC in the middle of the night and how it portrays incarcerated people and what a contrast this is to this, which is not some kind of voyeuristic attempt to show people in the worst moments of their life, but an opportunity to show people experience fulfillment and joy and pleasure and humor and also pain and suffering and the full complexity of people who happen to be incarcerated, but are as fraught and terrific and brilliant as any of the rest of us, if not more.
Thank you so much, Max. So now we will jump right into our questions. I'd like to start by asking Giovanni and Daiwan, how did the Bard Prison Initiative prepare you for life after prison? And how do you think the education it provides will need to change in the contemporary moment, whether in preparation for the ongoing pandemic and the opening up of our cities, or in the light of the recent resurgence of the Black Lives Matter movement?
So how did the Bard Prison of, how did BPI prepare me for my release? And one of the things I say, and I always like to highlight this because you watch the film and you see how rigorous the education is, but you know, there's a, also other access aspects of the story that are just as important. And so you see us sitting in rooms, sitting around with each other, interacting with our professors, interacting with each other, engaging in civil discourse in a very, very robust way. And so one of the things that, you know, my experience in BPI did for me tangential to the education is really prepared me to re-enter society and engage with people. You know, the way that I engage with my peers in the classroom is how I engage with my coworkers today. You know, how I engage with my professors, how I engage with my bosses. And so I think there's a social component to college and prison that is just as important to the education. In respect to, you know, the education that we receive at BPI, it was a liberal arts education. In the context of this moment, you know, everyone just saw Rodney Spivey's senior project, and that was written years ago, right? And that work couldn't be more relevant at this time. And here's someone who wrote that from a prison cell. Right. And so liberal arts education really brought me to engage and other students to engage more deeply with the world. And then in relation to COVID, one of the things I've been really, really proud of in this moment is that BPI has a public health fellowship, and our public health fellows have been really, really engaged on the front lines in their communities, working around this issue and writing around this issue. And we also have a number of alumni who have just been hired as contact tracers in the city. And so, you know, the work that we do in the classroom translates really well back into society.
Well, you know, of course, I agree with everything that Daiwan just said. There's nothing there that I didn't experience myself, you know. And I think for me, what I feel like was something that was key in preparation that I gained from my education was more so was the ability to think differently, was realizing that, like, in writing all those papers and struggling with all those theses, it wasn't necessarily about the A, but about, like, how I was training my brain to think and, like, figure things out either more efficiently, and seeing how that translated outside of the classroom for me was, like, a really big wow moment, right? Seeing how I managed social relationships, like Taiwan said, outside of the classroom differently, based on just, like, the way my brain was just being trained to think differently from the rigorousness of the education, of the curriculum. You know, bringing that outside with me, I felt much more empowered and just comfortable, you know, re-entering into society, because I understood, you know, that I was educated and I was capable, you know, and BPI helped me, you know, the education I got through the program helped me realize that. In terms of COVID, for me, what I've been tasked and I've been charging with through my organization has been, like, providing resources to our community so that they can stay either informed or engaged, whatever they choose to do. You know, I think that, you, like Taiwan mentioned, a lot of it is just, like, seeing BPI alum and being, you know, staying abreast of what's going on in the situation, having conversations about it, and educating the people around them about, you know, what to believe and what, you know, not to believe. There's a lot of things out there that there are, you know, a hyperbole, and I think that, you know, we do our due diligence when we are really looking for the information.
Definitely. Thank you both. So I'm going to open it up to everyone. In each of your perspectives, how can we increase accessibility to programs like the Bard Prison Initiative, as well as further engagement for incarcerated folks interested in higher education opportunities? And Max, can you kick us off this time?
Sure. You know, I don't think that we need to do all that much to encourage engagement of incarcerated people in educational opportunities. Our experience is that whatever we are able to provide that's of real quality and dignity in prisons, people are ready to take advantage of. So the question for us is how we restore college and prison in a way that not only sort of checks a box and makes sure that some people who are incarcerated have an opportunity to complete college credits or earn a transcript or maybe even be conferred a degree, but to engage in the kind of education that Taiwan and Giovanni just described. And that does two things. It provides the kind of education that honors the full breadth and capacity and ambitions of a student's imagination, that doesn't assume because they're in prison, they're only interested in or capable of certain things. And that's all too common in the United States. But also the second thing, which Giovanni really emphasized, is that sense of community, right? In this COVID moment, we are seeing so much of higher education, and we're seeing an incredible acceleration of higher education being moved to forums like this one online. And as college moves this way, we'll find that it will only be the luckiest, the richest, the most entitled among us who benefit from a college education that really builds the kind of community that Taiwan and Giovanni just described. And all of us at Bard, perhaps at Columbia, need to work overtime to make sure that we are shining counterexamples to that trend that is coming and that will harm.
Yeah, and just to pick up on Max's point of that, we don't need to do much to encourage incarcerated people to enroll in college and prison programs. You know, every time BPI does enrollment, we have a ton more eligible students than we have spots, right? And so the problem is not a lack of students. The problem is the capacity to meet the demand. And I think the number one obstacle here is funding. You know, for anyone who doesn't know the history, prior to 1994, incarcerated people in this country were eligible for Pell Grants. Overnight, with the passing of the 1994 crime bill, which made incarcerated people ineligible for federal Pell Grants, we went from having about 800 college and prison programs nationally to less than 10, right? And so if we are to restore college and prison, to offer this type of opportunity to incarcerated people at the scale that is mass incarceration in this country, we need to restore Pell.
All right, so to just follow up on what both Max and Daiwan just said, for me, I think another point, another way of like really, you know, getting this program or getting to a point where, you know, so many other, much more people can have access to this program is just, you know, we have to change the narrative, right? We have to change this narrative where we believe that, you know, education is a privilege, and it's, you know, and harder like a resource, like it's gonna run out, and it's never, and it never is, essentially, right? And so, one second. Yeah, I was a bit parched, but yeah, it's about changing the narrative about, you know, who prisoners are and humanizing us, you know, people who are incarcerated, and let you know, people have stories. People did not just end up in there because, you know, it was, you know, the one thing that they wanted to do with their lives, right? There are a lot of other things, a lot of other factors that come into play. And, you know, we need to, as a society, sort of, you know, take a look and really consider those things in totality. You know, so there's a narrative shift that, you know, I believe it's happening. I believe Dark Film has been helping, you know, drive this narrative change. But we have to continue to just like really have these conversations that we're having now with many more people, so that people can, you know, understand why it's beneficial for everyone to have access to this sort of education.
I want to touch on a point that Daiwan mentioned, the importance of restoring the Pell Grant, as well as of what Giovanni was just talking about with the narrative change. So I'm wondering, how can policy and advocacy organizations work together to restore educational opportunities?
I think, you know, these things have to go hand in hand. Right. You know, at BPI, we are primarily an educational institution. Right. But at the same time, we do a great deal of advocacy around restoring Pell or restoring TAP or expanding access to education in prison. And so these things have to be done in tandem. In I think really it's the only way to do it. And one of the most important aspects of it is foregrounding the direct lived experience of the people you see in this film, of people who have been directly impacted by the criminal justice system, but who have remarkably been able to transform their lives around through the power of education, you know, not only at BPI, but at other schools doing this work in the prison context. And so, you know, when we're working on Pell, you know, we may be going to DC and doing a screening in DC. We did three of them last year, right? There are other organizations taking formerly incarcerated people into meetings with senators and congressmen every day, you know, Prison Fellowship, Vera, to meet with their representatives and be walking arguments for the value of college and prison. So I think that these things go hand in hand, and we have to be fighting this battle on both fronts.
I agree, and I you can't emphasize enough Daiwan's first point that restoring Pell eligibility, or more precisely, getting rid of a specific ban on one group of people, Pell eligibility, is the first and most important thing we can do in this field. It will create ballast for a field across the country and ensure that programs in every state have the opportunity to come into being and to survive. But the second thing requires vigilance on the state and local level. And that is, when we have college and prison, we need to ensure that what that does is expand the space of college, not expand the space of prison. That is to say, you know, what you've just seen in this film is incarcerated students with college faculty in a space that physically is within the prison, but when the door closes, it genuinely resembles college. It behaves like college, it feels like college, it sounds like college, people are behaving, like college faculty and college undergraduate students. That's what we need. And that's not guaranteed. And we need to restore its funding in order to make that possible. But then after that funding is restored, we need to be vigilant about how programs are being run and how what space they're being permitted to have by the prisons themselves.
Giovanni, please go ahead.
Well, no, yeah, I think for me, I just wanted to note that, you know, while advocacy, right, and, you know, pushing our legislators to make the appropriate changes, you know, that we want to see, in addition to that, sort of like, you know, it's not just like to wait for our, you know, necessary, you know, to while advocating, but not necessarily, while advocating for the legislative change, not just wait on that, right, and do more. There, you know, if you're going to organization, they can start, you know, there are other schools who have started other prison programs, support them if they can, right, there are other, you know, I just don't want it to be something where, like, we're advocating for legislative change, but there are a lot of organizations that have resources or have other ways of supporting, right, college and prison programs, of helping them expand so that in the meantime, you know, these smaller programs can grow.
Thank you. We have a ton of questions coming through the question and answer, so I will ask just one final question before we turn over to that segment of our programming. So I'd want to know, if we imagine a post-COVID world that takes systemic racism seriously, how do each of you envision the future of education in the justice system? And we've talked about the expansion of college programs, what would that look like, how would it expand across the state, across the nation? What are your thoughts?
To me, it's not exactly the question I would seek to answer. Of course, if we're going to have prisons and jails in any kind of way similar to the way in which we have for a generation and a half now, our view is that education should be available in those places in a meaningful and transformative way. But you know that. I think the more important question is, what is the relationship between education and justice, broadly speaking? And, you know, in 1988, in New York State, for example, we spent hundreds of millions of dollars more on our state university system than we did on our prison system. And by 1998, we spent many millions, hundreds of millions of dollars more than that on our prison system than our college system. The relationship was inversed, right? So less than what should the place of education be within prisons moving forward, I think we need to restore the United States as a place, as a country, as a society, where we have optimism about the future and where we value people enough such that we have the courage to invest more in things like education that have a promise for a better tomorrow than prisons, which are about confining and inflicting harm on others.
Yeah, everything Max just said, and I just like to highlight, you know, back to the economics of this, that, you know, at BPI, we can educate a student at about a cost of $8,000 a year. It costs over $70,000 a year here in New York State to keep that person incarcerated, right? And so when we're talking about the value of doing one versus the other, education is obviously a no-brainer. You know, not only do people get an education, but they get out of prison and they don't go back. And so when you have people not going back to prison, you're closing that revolving door. But when the problem is that when this is not happening at the scale that is mass incarceration, you don't see a large impact. You know, we have a lot of calls in this country to decarcerate, right? And I think it's really, really important in this moment to always remember that there are millions of people in prisons and jails, right? So we're seeing a lot of reforms on the front end, bail reforms. We're seeing some stuff on the back end in terms of parole reforms. We don't see anyone talking about what's happening in the middle, right? And so the space in which we operate in at BPI is doing something from those people who are going to be stuck in the system, right? Despite all the reforms so that when they go back to their communities, they have the tools that they need to build better lives for themselves, right? And so, yeah, we want to decarcerate, we want to defund the police, we should be allocating that money back into our communities, back into our schools. And I meet with legislators here in New York State, at the New York City level all the time. That's my job. And I'm constantly lobbying them for the value of education over incarceration. And one of the points I constantly have to make, and Giovanni makes it for me in the film, is that prison didn't do anything for me, right? Bard College did something for me. And there's an important difference. It is really, really important, as Max said, as we move forward, as we talk about expanding college and prison, as we talk about decarceration, as we talk about defunding the police, is that we make sure that we have colleges that are allowed to operate in prisons, but we don't have prisons operating colleges.
Giovanni, do you want to add to that, or should I?
Well, no, there's not much I could add to that, honestly, except like reiterate something that they've already said. They made so many valid points. Toward, you know, the value of education, you know, it's not, you know, if anything like that wants or lose who or mentions is like anything that, you know, the BPI program shows that education is something, you know, that is transformative in a much more meaningful way than incarceration, and that, you know, education, you know, investment in education should be looked at as a prescriptive remedy for some issues rather than like investment in incarceration and in prisons, right? We should be looking at it just like, oh man, we should be providing people with the tools to not mess up before they mess up, and not saying like, oh man, you know, people go to college and then they mess up and then they work, you know, and then they get an education and it works. No, it would have worked for me had I had access to that quality education as a kid.
Definitely. Thank you. We're going to now transition into the question and answer portion. The first question is directed towards Daiwan and Giovanni. Has graduating from the Bard Prison Initiative helped you break down any negative social stigmas surrounding formerly incarcerated people, given that you now hold a college degree?
Yeah, you know, I think definitely one of the benefits about having a Bard degree and being a Bard alumni is that you get to engage with really smart people all the time. And I was speaking to one of my professors, Professor Robert Times, fairly recently, and we were talking about the words transformation and change and the problematics of them as referring to people, right? You change your shoes, you change your socks, you don't change who you are, right? I am who I am because of who I was, to say that in a pretty succinct way. But, you know, my professor made the argument to me. He says, you know, Daiwan, I'd argue that, you know, BPI changed you, transformed you in some way, or you changed or transformed in reaction to BPI. But one of the things, and I think it's interesting, is even more important, is how the work that you did in BPI changed society's perception of you, starting with your professors, starting with your peers, the faculty, but also how you're received when you get out of prison. You know, it impacts the way that your family looks at you, right? It changes the conversation when you're sitting down inside an interview. And one of the things I always like to highlight is that I don't only have a degree, I also have a very fine education, but the degree in this world as a credential is very, very important. There are people who will speak to me, who will sit down to me just for the fact that I have a degree for Bard College who wouldn't do so otherwise. That is unfair, but that is the society we live in. And so having this education, having this degree has opened many, many doors for me that would have otherwise been closed.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I don't want to reiterate everything you said. I agree with everything you said. And I think that, you know, again, you know, we live in a society where unfortunately, you know, that piece of paper matters more than whether you actually learned the things that, you know, they the piece of paper implies you learned. You know, fortunately, we have both, right? We got a really, we got really great educations that allowed us to sort of explore our potential in ways that we, you know, nothing else that was provided for us in prison could. And that, of course, you know, being able to sort of just like realize my potential, you know, has brought for me an empowerment that like out here I wield, you know, because I understand the value of it. I understand that like I can handle myself in any academic space because I have through the classrooms with really intelligent professors. And that has trained me and given me the confidence to engage in the world with anyone, right? In addition to that, like he said, you know, having the piece of paper sort of gives you that validation for people who don't necessarily have the time to sort of get to know how exactly how smart you are, right? Having the paper sort of gets people that, you know, it's the credential, it's the, your ability to use the social, that, that as social capital. You have this degree.
Yeah, I just want to touch on another aspect of this, because I think whenever we're talking about education and incarceration, we're having coded conversations about race. And it just takes me back to a story that a professor told me. He was giving a lecture to some high school students, and one of the students raised his hand and said, "Professor, like, I hear everything you're saying, that's all and good, but why are you talking like a white person?" And the professor, Craig Wilder, who's African-American, you know, said back to the student, "I'm not talking like a white person, I'm speaking like an educated person," right? And so what it means to be educated and Black in this world really overturns caricatures in stereotypes. And that is really, really powerful.
Yes, I completely agree. Thank you for sharing that story, Daiwan. And Giovanni, I really loved your point by saying, you know, you can do it because you have done it in the past. So thank you for that powerful remark as well. The next
question. Thank you.
Of course. The next question is directed towards Max. I want to know, or this was an audience question, so how do you respond to critics of these programs in comparison to non-prison college degree programs?
I'm not exactly sure I understand the question, but if, you know, the classic criticism of college and prison, isn't a criticism that says this doesn't work, or that it doesn't do things like reduce recidivism, which is sort of a derogatory metric through which everyone wants to evaluate our work. But it's a moral argument of why would you give this opportunity to those people, right? Frankly, a bigoted argument. That education should only be the purview of the elite, of people that are lucky, of people who can afford it, etc. And as Wes articulated so beautifully in the film, not only is that cruel, but it's also short-sighted for all of us because it discounts extraordinary amount of capacity and talent and ambition and potential contributions that others can make. And there's no place you can go in the United States and encounter more underutilized human capacity or human potential than our systems of jail and prisons.
Thank you. Giovanni or Daiwan, is there anything you would like to add before we go on to the next question?
I just add in relation to it being short-sighted that 95% of the people incarcerated in this country are getting out someday. They're going back to their communities. And as Tamika says in the film, you need to, people should be really thinking about how you want those people returning to society, right? Do we want to live in a society where 60% of the people get out of prison every year are back within 3 years? Or do we want to live in a society where people go to prison, have a chance to transform their lives, and have a less than 4% chance of going back to prison?
Thank you. Giovanni, is there anything from you? The next question is, how can the average citizen support higher education in incarcerated populations?
Taiwan, I was sure you were going to jump in there, but
I can. I think one of the things that I have found most amazing since I've got out of prison is the amount of opportunity that has been allotted to me just by the average person in the world who would hear my story, who may have never heard, who may have never talked to an incarcerated person before, who would hear my story, who would find it interesting. And I've been able to network with people. I've been able to find jobs. And so I think if you're the average person sitting around thinking about what you can do, if you own a business or a company, do you have any formerly incarcerated people on your staff, right? That's a really, really easy way to make a really deep impact in the world. If you're an average person and you're seeing this film, share it with your friends, share it with your family, have a discussion group, get people engaged around this issue, right? And I'm always going to say give to BPI, because the work that we do, it does cost money. And unfortunately, we don't have many things that volunteers can do for us. We can't send people to do the money that people get to us really, really goes a long way.
Yeah, I would say, you know, we need to let our elected officials know not just that you believe in this work, but that you believe it's a priority, that you think a transformation of the prison system and the shrinking of the prison system, dramatic shrinking of the prison system, are high priorities for New York State. That's number one. Number two, like Daiwan said, we are organizations that exist because of the generosity of individuals. So we're not a college with a multi-billion dollar endowment. We exist based on the generosity and optimism of others. So we always have our head out and don't apologize for it, and hope that the work that our students do, these incarcerated students do, can be an argument for educational access, not just in jails and prisons across the United States, but everywhere across the United States.
Definitely. Thank you, Max.
Yeah, I just can't stress how much, you know, Daiwan's first point was really just like such a valid point for me, because, you know, I could have all the education in the world that, you know, the Bard College have, you know, could have afforded me, but if no one gives me the opportunity to utilize that, then it essentially means nothing, right? I can't be productive, and so, providing individuals who are formerly incarcerated with the opportunities to restart, to prove that their trajectories have, they want different trajectories, that that they're capable, right? And sort of that, those starts, opportunities essentially can change the culture in a company, right? Bringing someone who's never been into contact with someone who's formerly incarcerated into contact with someone who's been formerly incarcerated, but also who's been formerly incarcerated and who's been, gone through a program like BPI, really can help drive not just the cultural change, but the narrative change that I was talking about earlier, right? And so, like, people who do have the ability to do that, that is one of the major ways of, one, effecting change, not only in your work culture, but in the, in the personal lives of the people who work for you, and in the person who you're hiring, because, it statistics show that someone who comes home and can get a job is much less likely to recidivate than someone who doesn't, right? Largely, people go back because they cannot find opportunity.
Thank you. The next question is for everyone. How are you navigating the matter of being advocates for education in prison facilities at both incremental, so site-specific, and systemic, which is the entire jurisdiction? And do you find that engaging in justice reform at both levels can come into conflict?
No, I don't think there's any conflict in the work that I do. I spent 12 years in prison. There are some of my colleagues who spent 15 years in prison, who spent 20 years in prison, who spent 30 years in prison, right? And so what education and college and prison has done for me in my colleagues. It has done something that no other reform was going to do, right? No one was going to let me out of prison early, right? And so college and prison gave me an opportunity to make the most of the time that I spent in prison, right? It gave me the opportunity to do something productive, not only for myself, but for my community in a context where the other option is you sit in your cell, maybe you read, maybe you work out, and you spend 15 years in prison and you get out and you're the same person you were at 16, at 21, right? And so I don't think there's a conflict in that aspect of the work. In relation to our work being, you know, focused and concentrated, we're in 6 prisons in New York State. We're about as big as at BPI as we can responsibly be. We have an allergy to doing things in an ad hoc way, right? We have a responsibility to our students to give them the types of education that are only reserved in this country to the privileged and the few. And you can't do that at a mass scale. But if we have Pell money in this space, if we have other institutions doing this work, then we have more college in prison, we have more people getting out, we have more people not going back to prison, right? And so at the end of the day, college in prison, I think, ends up being an abolitionist agenda, right? Because people, this breaks cycles of recidivism in one of the most dramatic ways that we see, right? There is nothing else in the long term that has been is solidly proven to reduce recidivism. And as Max pointed out, this is such a low metric of our work because not only do our students not go back to prison, they go on to get PhDs from Ivy League universities. They go on to do amazing work in their communities. They go on to be brothers, sisters, and fathers and responsible voting, tax-paying members of society, right? So recidivism is a really, really low bar. We're talking about the success of these programs. But I have to stress, you know, breaking that revolving door and doing something for the 2 million people who are in prison at the moment and for those people who are going to be in prison for years or decades on end, the value of that cannot be underestimated.
I would only add to that, and I agree with everything Daiwan just said, especially the importance of focusing less on recidivism and on the positive contributions that our people make. The same's true in the, you know, at the public policy level. And that is to say that in criminal justice reform, for all the victories that we've had in the last number of years, for all the bipartisan consensus that has been established that we have to reduce the size of these prison systems across the country. That consensus only goes so far as how we make things less bad. That consensus only goes so far as how we destroy some systems that we have built. And it's the right thing. We should do that. But we have no consensus about what comes next. We have no consensus about what to invest in to actively make things better. And that's where I think the successes of our students and alumni are an example to the country and a reminder that a serious education is something that people are still capable of and interested in and fulfilled by, and that will make the United States a better place if we provide that for many more people.
I'm sorry, what was the question again? I don't think I understood
it. I'd be happy to repeat it.
Please.
It was, how are you navigating the matter of being advocates for education in prison facilities at both incremental, so site-specific, and systemic, which includes entire jurisdictions? And do you find that engaging justice reform at both of those levels can come into conflict?
Oh, no. So I agree with everything that Max and Daiwan said. You know, I think that, you know, my work as like, an advocate. It's more of an identity. I feel like it's a duty, right? One of the things that I learned, I learned through, you know, pursuing higher education was, you know, my civic duty, right? And what it meant to be a citizen, you know, and the responsibilities and the importance of that and the power of that, especially in community. And so, you know, like Daiwan mentioned, there are so many people still inside who are our friends, who we spent years with, who, you know, who are continuing to struggle in a place that essentially doesn't offer anything as beneficial as a college education, right? And, you know, the matter that we are site-specific does, you know, we believe, does, you know, work in our favor, right? We're able to keep the education as rigorous as we're able to keep it because we aren't getting so big. But the fight to advocate for Pell Grant on restoration is the fight for, like Daiwan said, to get other people in the ring, right? To get other institutions in the ring and make it easier for them to get in the ring. To provide these opportunities for people, like he said, who are in there, who will be in there, because we haven't deconstructed the systems that have driven mass incarceration yet. And so, you know, it'd be, you know, I think that for me, Daiwan, and a lot of our alum in particular, you know, those people are not just our, you know, our alums, are not our friends. They are community members, right? Many of us come from the same communities, you know. By and large, most of the people who are in prison are people of color. And so, like, you know, we want for them just what we want for us, right? We want them to have the same opportunity we had because we understand how beneficial and how great it was for us. And we want them to have that, right? And not just them, we want everyone to have that, right? It's not just a thing where it's like, we want only people who are incarcerated to have access. We believe that everyone should have access to such, to these types of education.
Thank you, Giovanni. We're going to ask our final question of the evening. And this question is directed to everyone. How do we balance transformative reform focused on completely eliminating mass criminalization and punishment while also making sure that folks inside aren't forgotten? When thinking about how some people advocate against projects that aim to improve living conditions inside carceral settings, some might say this reform work takes away from abolitionist work and that they work to uphold the same racist systems. Do you have any thoughts on this tension between transformation and reform?
I think it's a real tension and one we constantly have to navigate and consider. But we can't. 95% of people who are incarcerated return into their communities. In what shape do we want, mindset, do we want them people returning to society? With what types of skill sets, right? And so if we do nothing in that space, right? If there's nothing going on inside of prison except people staring at walls, except brutality, then we keep that revolving door revolving. And we don't see decarceration happening at a fast enough rate that it's gonna make a dramatic change in our generation, right? So I think the tension is real. I think we constantly have to be navigating it and we constantly have to be aware of it, but we can walk and chew gum at the same time, right? There is no reason why we can't educate people in prison at the same time that we're closing prisons, right? Closing prisons is not closing colleges, right? If they close Eastern Correctional Facility tomorrow, Bard College does not close, right? We don't have a stake in the prison system. We have a stake in the people who are incarcerated in those institutions. That is where our interests are at BPI. And I think more broadly that we all just have to nurture some sense or some belief in human dignity, right? There are people in prison who have been locked out of all types of opportunity in this country. And we're speaking about minorities, particularly been locked out of access, higher education, that when we're doing education in prison, this is not only about criminal justice reform. We shouldn't reduce it to that. This is also about social equity, you know? One of the things I say in the film is totally true. If I'd never gotten education in prison, I would have never gotten education, right? And so that is sad, but that's the reality. And I think that's the reality for a lot of incarcerated people. We have to be doing both. There's no reason. There's no reason that we should be doing, that we have to do one and out the other. And if they tell us that the money isn't there, I'm going to tell you that the money is there. In the 1994 crime bill, you know, they stripped about $45 million away from Pell eligibility for people in prison and allocated $7 billion to prison construction, enough to fund college and prison for 200 years. So it's not a question of scarcity. It's a question of how we are allocating public dollars. Emphasis here on public.
You know, I agree, just to like follow up on that one. I agree with everything he just said. There's no reason why it has to be an either or, right? There are still the same way that we're trying to stop people from falling into the trap of, you know, that is mass incarceration, these pipelines, right? These kids on the school to prison pipeline is a real thing. I fed, you know, into that. Like, and so we also have to be trying to stop people from, you know, falling into that trap, but also remember the people who already fell into that trap, right? And considering that 95% of the people who are incarcerated will at one point return, like all of these people are going to be our neighbors. They're going to be the people who either, you know, who either work the jobs that we go to or the people that we walk through in the street. And if we do nothing for them, then we're essentially abandoning them, right? We're to an institution that, on it, quite frankly, does very little to afford you the opportunities to transform, right? I would not be the person I am today had it not been for the education that I was afforded. I did the vocational training, I did my GED in prison, I did every single program that they required me of, and nothing was as transformative or as impactful as the education, right? I will always be a proponent for education, like I said, and not just inside and outside. I think it should be used as a way to address things in both places. Why not, right? As Dawan said, the money's there. It's just a matter of priority. And I think that recently we've sort of, you know, got an idea of where the priority has been for a long time. And as a community, as a society, we can push for, you know, the priorities that we want to be pushed. I think that, you know, both prison reform and you know, they both are important in the battle that we're fighting right now.
I think, you know, at the human level, what both Darwan and Giovanni have said about not abandoning people is compelling and real and frankly a problem with the abolitionist argument. As much as we all want to reduce prisons to as small a set of institutions as we possibly can, I think also we certainly as educators want to work to make college accessible, highest quality college accessible to people everywhere, irrespective of these arguments or what institutions are good or bad in the United States. But, you know, just before we go, I do have one confusion thing to say about the abolitionist argument, which is that it tends to come from a left-wing perspective and a perspective that's insightful and highly critical of sort of 400 years of racial oppression in the United States. But what surprises me about it is that given that 400 years, it presumes that if we got rid of prisons, whatever came next would necessarily be better. And so as we talk about dismantling the system, I think it's imperative that we play the long game. And as much as we divest in one set of institutions, we invest in another that will make America more just, more fair, and less racist.
Thank you, Max. That was extremely powerful. I want to end by thanking each of our panelists for their invaluable contributions to this discussion. I want to reiterate that the full four-part documentary, College Behind Bars, is currently streaming on Netflix and is available for free on PBS. Finally, I would like to thank our audience for your time and engagement given the current racial injustices facing our nation. While in this watershed moment, we remain committed to advancing the national and individual conversation needed for reckoning and lasting reform that we hope will define this generation. Thank you and good evening.